your story. It's my fingerprint in the valley. There is confidence in the shadow. I will be your strength. One thing's for sure, I am your Lord.
Yeah. Good morning, Calvary Chapel, North Miami. How are you guys doing this morning? Good, 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 good. Glad to be here with you guys. My name is Daryl Bird. I'm one of the volunteers here, and this is my beautiful wife,
Natasha Bird.
We're so glad to be here, and we have a word that we wanted to share with you. It comes from James chapter 2. Looking at verses 14 through 16, and it says, "What good is it, my brother, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can this faith save him? If a brother or sister is without clothes and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, keep warm, and eat well,' but you do not give them what the body needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith, if it doesn't have works, is dead by itself." Want to elaborate on that?
Yeah, and wanted to say happy Palm Sunday. And this morning, that was the verse that I was reading, and I was just reflecting on the goodness of our God. And faith without works is dead. And many of us, we have our faith. We believe in God. We trust in Him. We hope in Him. And on the weary days, the tough days, we get up, we thank God we have Him, and we have a hope for tomorrow. We have faith that His word is true, and that when He says that there is a heaven, and that beyond this earth, we get heaven if we accept Him. But then the part of the works, and it led me to today, Palm Sunday, and the work that Jesus did for us, for our salvation. So as we talk about our faith and we hold fast to our faith, the work that we get to do here on earth to rightly represent Him beyond just believing in Him, it's when we love our neighbor, when we do those things that God calls us to in obedience, even when we don't want to. That's what Jesus did. And so today, as I reflect personally on Palm Sunday, Sunday and the triumphant entry, and they laid down palms and they rode Him in on a donkey, and they were calling Him the son of God, and they were praising Him, and that Jesus in that journey knew the work that He had to fulfill. It wasn't just His faith alone, knowing that the Father had good things. I can only imagine, because remember, Jesus felt every emotion and every feeling of what we felt. As He is riding in, He was flooded, I'm sure, with emotions, acknowledging what this week, our Holy Week, what was to come. They were praising Him in this moment. They were giving Him His accolades in this moment. But Jesus knew the work that He had to fulfill for you and I, us, all of us. And so I just spur you on to that verse and just be reminded that our faith without works is truly dead. And Jesus was the perfect example of this. It was by faith that God sent Him here to die on the cross for us, but it was the works. He could have chosen anything else. He could have went and hid. He could have ran back out. They brought the donkey. He could have said, "I ain't getting on it," all of the above. But no, He fulfilled the promise. He went all the way to completion, and He fulfilled the great work that His Father had for Him. And won't you join Him in that journey, that having your faith, but completing the work that He's prepared for you?
Amen, amen. I have nothing to add to that. No, that entry was called a triumphant entry. He knew what He had to go into. Right? While they're celebrating Him, He knows what has to happen to Him. He knows the beating that He has to take. He knew the work that needed to be done to be able to extend the gift of salvation to you and me. And He triumphantly went into that. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come before You and we give You thanks as we celebrate Palm Sunday. May we be reminded of what You have done, Lord. A triumphant entry, Lord. Extending salvation to us. Taking the beating that we deserve. You did that. May we not lose sight of that. And may we confidently and boldly step out proclaiming the gospel for the world to know. So we ask that you strengthen us, that you lead us, that you guide us. We come today with open hands and open hearts, ready to receive what you have for us. We ask that you allow Eddie to decrease and you increase as he bring forth the word. And may you get the glory and honor. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. If you could stand on your feet. It is in and through him we have victory and freedom. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Step out of the grave, break into the wild, don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be all of your burdens, bring all of your scars. Come back to communion, come back to the start. Run into wide open spaces, grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. Where the Spirit is here, let there be shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Where the Spirit of the Lord
I've searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along. Oh, there's nothing.
I see His love and mercy washing over all of our sin. The people see, the people see. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna. John 12:12 says, the next day a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took branches and palm trees and went out to meet him. And they cried out, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. King of Israel has arrived. Hosanna, Hosanna, the King has arrived. There should be joy this day. The King has arrived. His promise was fulfilled. He would come to Jerusalem on that donkey. He would enter into the gates as promised. Hosanna. And they laid out the branches and they welcomed him. Today we celebrate this fulfilled promise, because it is but one of others coming this week, Holy Week, a week where God's promises become fulfilled even more. Let us not miss out on this, that he rode in on that lonely donkey. They yelled out, King of Israel. He is king. We know that he doesn't turn out to be the king later, but there is a future to come where he will come on a king. He will come on his horse. He will come with his children riding on the horse on that second time back on earth. He will return. But today we celebrate the simple, simple act, the fulfillment of the prophecy of his father. Knowing that this laid the foundation for all humanity, Israelites and Gentiles alike, to come to know the saving grace of the Father through his Son, Jesus. And so, Father, we just thank you right now. We thank you that you fulfilled the promise. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, mounting that donkey, coming into the cheers, knowing what was waiting for him later that Friday, knowing what he would have to go through on the cross, but even more so knowing what the end result would be for all humanity, Lord. And so today we celebrate you. We thank you for that. We thank you for that promise being fulfilled. One of many that you've promised and one of many you have fulfilled. And you still have so much more for us, Lord. And so we thank you for that today. As we sing Hosanna, Hosanna, let us not forget and have that heart set. Let it not let it just be an event that happened. Let it not just be a church thing that we do, a ceremonial thing that we do. May it be a heart set, knowing that you came for us, lonely sinners who were rebellious against you. And so when we sing this again, Hosanna, Hosanna, let that be your heart set. Know that you are singing to God Almighty for the wonderful and matchless thing that he did. Let's sing this again. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Welcome to Calvary Chapel North Miami. We're a multicultural, multi-generational, non-denominational church here in the heart of Miami Gardens, where we grow, go, and show the love of Jesus, because we believe a relationship with Jesus changes everything. Hi, my name is Dulce, and if this is your first time here, welcome. We'll love to meet you, greet you, and get to know you. So meet us at the tents after service, where we'll have a special gift waiting for you. If this is your first time joining us online on our YouTube channel, type first time in the chat and one of our online hosts will connect with you. Here at CCNM, we have something for everybody. Starting with Wednesday night's Bible study at 7 p.m., this is where we dig deeper into the Word of God as we learn, grow, and build community with each other. Men's ministry meets every Thursday at 7 p.m. Calvary Woman meets every second and fourth Saturday of the month right here at CCNM at 5 p.m. Marriage ministry meets every third Friday at 7 p.m. and our Youth Alive youth ministry meets every first and third Saturday at 11 a.m. right here at CCNM. You could also find a list of all of our special events on our Facebook page under the Events tab. Also, if you haven't done so as yet, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, Calvary Chapel North Miami, and make sure to hit that notification button so that we never miss whenever we go live or post any new weekly content. Before we get into the preaching and teaching, please remember to put your phones on silent and don't forget to scan the QR code so you can go along with today's teaching. And always remember, a relationship with Jesus changes everything.
Hey guys, Pastor Darren here, and of course I have my beautiful bride with me,
Christine.
I call her Bunny. We miss you. We're on a cruise right now, while at the same time we're on the camera. Listen, we just want to remind you to join us Resurrection Sunday, but don't just meet us here. Meet us here with your family, friends, and loved ones. Take one of those flyers, get it to your friends, invite someone. We want to see your face in the place as we celebrate God's grace, Resurrection Sunday. And so, make sure you invite a family member, invite a friend, invite a loved one, cousin, sister, auntie, brother, all of them, because we believe a relationship with Jesus changes everything.
So that's why you're not here? Because you out on a cruise? I hope you have a good time. Unc is your favorite nephew, DJ Mr. Ian. I just want to say happy birthday. Much blessings to you. And but it's not just me. A whole school of people here at church want to say happy birthday to and some extended family members. So check it out. Let's get it.
Is this thing on?
Oh, hey, Pastor Darren from the youth ministry.
Hey, Pastor Darren, on behalf of the praise team, we just want to say happy birthday!
Happy birthday, Pastor Darren! We love you!
Pastor Darren, it's Thursday night. We're here at Men's Ministry, and we just want to say
happy birthday!
Happy birthday, Darren. Listen, I was thinking about, you know, what to say, and just thinking about the you are such a unique brother. I'm really, truly, sincerely grateful that God has brought you into my life and that we've been able to hang out and spend time together and get real. And because the thing, you know, you are such a showman, and I don't have a whole lot of the showman in me, but you're also incredibly real and authentic, and that's an unusual combination. You know, most of the time, people who are gifted as showmen, so to speak, find it difficult to just be open and honest and transparent. And you marry those two things beautifully. God uses you. And I pray that he will continue to do so and that this will be just the most fruitful year yet. Love you, brother. See you soon.
God bless you. This is Pastor Tony here. Hey, nephew, it's your unc. Happy birthday to you. And I just pray that God's blessings will be upon you. I pray that this will be some of the greatest years that you would experience in ministry and in your marriage. Hey, I'm proud of you, man. I'm proud to call you my nephew. Hey, it's from your aunt here. God bless you. Happy birthday.
All righty. Well, welcome everybody to Calvary Chapel, North Miami. How's everybody doing? Yes. You saw the video. Pastor Darren's birthday is actually on Tuesday. He is away with his wife. What's that? Monday. That's right. I'm glad someone reminded me. I would have texted him on Tuesday. Well, you can't even text him because he's on a cruise. So hopefully he put his phone away and he'll see this video likely afterwards. So thank you, Pastor Darren. From the whole family here who didn't get a chance to say, can we all say it once together? Happy birthday, Pastor Darren. There we go. All right. This is recorded on YouTube, so you got everybody loving on you. Hope you have a great time. My name is Eddie. I am a servant of the Lord here at CCNM. Blessed to see you all here. Those on YouTube, welcome as well. And I hope you're glad to be here. And if this is a tough time, well, you know what? You came to the right spot. It is Palm Sunday. The King has entered. He has entered into Jerusalem. And so we celebrate that today through worship and even through the Word. A couple of announcements just to, before we go into the Word today. For those who come on Wednesday nights for Bible study, we're not going to have Bible study this Wednesday. That means no young adults either. I know you're very sad about that. I'm always sad about that. But that's because we're going to have Good Friday service. And so we have Good Friday service coming up. We have the flyer somewhere up there. There's a flyer also here as well. Good Friday service, it's not on the flyer, 6:30. Normally do it at 7 o'clock for all those who have been here a long time. But this year it's a little earlier. Good Friday service going to be at 6:30 p.m. And then, once again, Sunday is Resurrection Sunday, regular service time, 10 a.m. Ooh, almost send you at the wrong time. Get a flyer. Give it out to people. Let them know. Invite, as Pastor Darren and Christine said. Also, if you weren't around Saturday, it rained. And we had an outreach. But God used it anyways to clean up the place and to do a lot of different things. But for those who are so looking for that car wash, we're going to redo it again this Saturday just before Easter. So if you want to come out for the car wash, it's going to be at 10 o'clock on Saturday here. And so, yeah, definitely, yeah, we're going to do an outreach to the community, free car wash. You can even bring your car to be washed as well. And then we're going to have a tent for prayer, because it takes a little bit of time for them to wash the car. You know, we're a little bit slow in washing car. We're not professional. So they'll go to the tent. There'll be some prayer counselors there. And we'll even have the beads for the kids, and we'll have some snacks. So it's a time also to minister to the community. So if you can come out Saturday, that will be wonderful. We teach verse by verse through the Bible. So if you do need a Bible, please raise your hand. Have some amazing ushers that have a Bible to give you. If you do have your Bible open, go ahead and open it up to the book of Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26. And so normally as a church, we would teach on Palm Sunday. We would teach probably from the book of John chapter 12. But this time around, leadership looked at it from a different perspective. And we're going to stay in the book of Acts today and also next Sunday, but we're going to bridge the two and see how what occurred on Palm Sunday is very important to what we're going to read about in Acts chapter 26. Same thing goes. So we'll be in Acts chapter 26. We're going to cover verses 1 through 18, but let me give you a recap of where we are at right now. Elder John taught on Acts chapter 25 last week. And his title was Appeal to Jesus. And he talked about the decisions you make will affect you tomorrow. If you didn't see that teaching or didn't hear that teaching, go back on our YouTube channel and check it out. And also, if you haven't subscribed, do so, please. So today, I am going to bridge Acts chapter 26 with Palm Sunday. And the main idea of the two, what's going to bridge them together, is the hopeful promise. You're going to hear that over and over, this hopeful promise of God. And so with that being said, we're going to be in Acts chapter 26, covering verses 1 through 18. We're also going to be in Genesis 3:15, if you're taking notes, John 14:6, and numerous other verses. So if you're a note taker, hang on. Here we go. My premise for this message tonight, I'm so used to Wednesday nights. I knew I was going to do that. Today is this: the hope in his promise can nullify the despair of our circumstances. The hope in his promise can nullify the despair of our circumstances. I titled this message, The Hopeful Promise of the Christ. Will you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, what a beautiful day this is, for it is the remembrance and the celebration of your Son entering into Jerusalem. Part of the hopeful promise that you gave Israel and all humanity. And so we thank you, Father, for this opportunity to come together and celebrate you. We thank you that we can come to this place, gather as brothers and sisters, grow and learn, lean on each other, pray for each other, exhort one another, encourage one another, cry with one another. And so, Lord, we thank you. And we ask right now that your Holy Spirit would just move in this place. Will you remove the distractions from the hearts of the people? Let them be prepared to just sit and soak. And you share the word that you have with them. And Father, as always, remove this man. Place your spirit. Let this teaching be about you, for you, to glorify you. We thank you for this time here. And I would be remiss, Father, if I don't lift up to you and petition the things that we're seeing in the world right now, Lord. Father, we lift up Haiti to you right now. We see the violence, the suffering that's going on in Haiti. And Father, all we can do is bend the knee, cry out to you, and ask that you would touch the hearts of leaders, of the men and women, not only in that country, but throughout the world, Lord. And that, Father, that this would be a country, Father, that would cry out, Hosanna, Hosanna, we need you more than ever. In their despair right now, Lord. As the children are suffering, there is no food, water. The violence continues to exist and grow, Lord. And so we lift up Haiti to you. We lift up the leaders that will make decisions. We lift up the people to you, Lord. We ask for your hand of revival of who you are in that nation, and that you will restore it to a nation that loves you, that follows you. We lift up Cuba to you, Lord, and all that's happening there with the lack of food and the people protesting. Once again, we ask for your hand and that you would break the hearts of those leaders to love you, to follow you, to treat their people as equals. Continue to do a work in them, Lord. Lord, we pray for our country and our borders, Lord. We pray for those that are dying each and every day to try to come to this land, Lord. We pray that our leaders would be smart enough, Father, to come up with a plan, Father, to help them, not to enable them, to assist them in their struggles, Lord. And to assist this country, to grow this country through immigration, not destroy it. So be with our leaders. Be with those in the front, those law enforcement officers trying to help. Be with those who are trying to come here for freedom. We ask for your hand upon them, Lord. And there are so many others throughout this world. We see it as the book of Revelation tells us. There is wars and rumors of wars. There's violence throughout. There's famine in Africa, Lord, that we pray for the people there. And we know what is needed is you. Not half of you, not three quarters of you, but all of you. That your people would come and bend the knee and follow you. And so we lift up these petitions to you, Lord, each and every one of them. We know you've heard every one of them, and you are working in each and every one of them for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, this idea of hopeful promise. If you are a basketball fan, yeah, one person. Two people, I'm sorry. You know this is the season for March Madness, or they call it the Big Dance. It is the male and female college basketball championship games going on. And so there is a frenzy of games going on, and there's a great hope in each player and each team. The hope is to perform at a high level that they may be victorious. For the promise, and the promise is that trophy, that fame, that accolade. And of course, for the schools, it's the money. Right, come on, let's be real. For the schools, it's the money. But there is a hope and a promise going on right now in them. As we study the scriptures today, there's also a hope and promise that goes beyond the simplicity of a trophy, of fame. Of even money. No, in our study, the hope of a promise of God will be carried in the heart of our main character today in their scriptures, which is the Apostle Paul. From his acts, you're going to see this hopeful promise just stirring him, guiding him throughout. It's going to elevate him beyond his circumstances as we look at them. And they're going to be challenging circumstances. But here's the key. This hopeful promise that is stirring Paul to continue on in his work, it's going to have eternal value. Not something that's fleeting. Not something that's just of this world. It's going to have eternal implications on anyone and everyone who would listen. And so, as we lay that foundation, we've been studying through the book of Acts now for almost a year and a half. We're coming towards the end. In chapter 24, we see that Paul is called back to Jerusalem, but the Holy Spirit reveals to him that there's going to be danger, but he's still called to go. And in Acts chapter 24, Paul is arrested and goes on trial, and he faces Felix, the Roman governor. And Felix has him brought up to Caesarea, and this is where he's incarcerated. Though Felix couldn't find an answer, couldn't give a reason why he should be arrested. Last week in Acts 25, 2 years later, we see a new Roman governor appointed, Festus. And he now hears Paul's case, and he is befuddled. He's trying to figure out, what do I charge this guy? Why is this guy in jail? And he can't figure it out. But yet, Paul is still in chains and in jail. And that leads us now to chapter 26. And while Festus is still examining this case of Paul, here comes a new character to the story. It is King Agrippa II. And his sister Bernice, and they're visiting Caesarea, which is northwest of Jerusalem, which sits right on the Mediterranean. And this is important ground, foundational knowledge to have. This King Agrippa and Bernice, by the way, they're brother and sister, and yeah, they're having sex together. This is an incestuous relationship. How do we know that? The Roman historian Josephus writes in detail about King Agrippa and Bernice. And so right away, you see the mindset. You know the mindset of King Agrippa and Bernice. This King Agrippa II, his father, King Agrippa I, was the one who had the Apostle James killed and the Apostle Peter arrested in Acts 12. So now you see his lineage. All this is important as we understand what Paul is going into. And so with that being said, we reverence God's word here. So would you please stand as I read? I'm going to read Acts chapter 26, just verses 1 to 3. You can follow along in your Bible. Acts 26, verses 1 to 3. The Bible says this. Then Agrippa said to Paul, "You are permitted to speak for yourself." So Paul stretched out his hand and answered for himself, "I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because today I shall answer for myself before you concerning all the things of which I am accused by the Jews, especially because you are an expert in all customs and questions which have to do with the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to hear me patiently." You may be seated. If you're taking notes, point number one of three this morning, the hopeful promise that supersedes bondage. The hopeful promise that supersedes bondage. Let me continue to lay this foundation out. The first thing that's said here is King Agrippa II tells Paul, "Hey, you can speak now." Here's the circumstances. Paul is jailed. He's not allowed to speak. Anybody remember as a kid and be a chatterbox and all of a sudden your parents say, "Be quiet." And you were like, "Whoa." You heard that voice. Kind of got offensive. Maybe you got quiet because you were afraid. Paul is being told here when he can speak and when he can't speak. And I want you to see this foundation because it's important to understand the environment he's in. And so now Agrippa gives him the authority to speak, but only speak on for himself. See, Paul's been in prison in 2 years for a crime he didn't commit. He's been falsely accused. No governor has been able to prove it. He hasn't been able to speak. And unlike the jails in our modern society, the jails in ancient Israel didn't have the luxuries. Listen, they didn't have cable TV. They didn't have running water. They didn't have time to go into the yard and go play basketball and lift weights. No, no. 2 years in a prison, shackled in a room, probably below ground with no ventilation, where the only place he could go to the bathroom is in the corner, rats and all kinds of creatures, and he's stuck there for 2 years. Could not be charged, no credible charge. Can you place yourself in that position? Think about it for a minute. Being charged of a crime and for 2 years being imprisoned with this type of circumstances. See, we fail at times as students of the Bible to put ourselves back into their place. But when we go there, all of a sudden, you start to begin to cringe. I was going to give you an illustration of what it looks like for Paul when they brought him up. I was actually going to have Jordan all chained up and taped up, but I said, you know what, let me not do that to Jordan. We pick on him enough. Yeah, he's saying praise God over there. He's like, yeah. But I can speak to what it's like to be in jail. I understand a little bit about what Paul. Why do I say that? At the age of 19, I committed a crime. Grand larceny, 2 counts. I know what it's like to be shackled. I know what it's like to sit in the back of a car, police car, And I know what it's like to be put into a box, caged up. Yes, it was only 6 hours, but those 6 hours, the most devastating, the most gut-wrenching time in my life. And see, there's this, and I'm giving you this foundation because we have a tendency to think that when we look at our jail system and we look at how Hollywood glorifies it, or the music industry glorifies jail, especially rappers, and I'm not going to mention any in particular, who glorify jail and going to jail as something as street credit, as something that builds you up, makes you a man, makes you powerful on the street. No, the truth of the matter is each and every one of those, and those who have been honest would truthfully say, that was the most devastating moment in their lives, to have freedom forever taken away from you. The freedom that we take for granted, gone. And so this idea, we have to understand, young people, going against the law and thinking that committing a crime and being arrested is going to make you better or help you in your future is a lie from Satan himself. He's just convincing you. He's tricked this world into believing that this is how you get street credit. This is how you get a good reputation. Let me give you a quote from a Christian rapper who said this: prison is not a place where a young man and woman is embraced. Prison is a place where a man and woman find nothing but disgrace. Prison does not give you strength or authority. Prison makes you weak as you become the minority. Unlike Paul, who went to jail for Christ, many who go to jail for their own selfishness and foolish pride. This is the picture. See, I give you that picture of jail because Paul's innocent. Paul did not commit this crime. But yet for 2 years, he sits there in this jail prison. But yet, here comes Paul's moment. 2 years later, he is brought out before King Agrippa. And King Agrippa now says, Paul, you can speak. And Luke writes that Paul's first acts in chains is to raise his hand up. Throughout the Bible, in the book of Acts, you could see it in Acts 13 and 21, Paul would do that. When Paul would raise his hand over the people, this wasn't a sign of authority, like some tyrants of the past. No, when he raised his hand above the people, this was a hand of blessing upon you. When he raised his hand towards the people, he was saying, may the Lord bless you and keep you, and I love you. And so even chained up 2 years, he raises his hand over the people. These are the same people that accused him. These are the same people that have no love for him. Yet he raises a hand of blessing over them. Paul, in his heart, understood what Jesus said in Matthew 5, 43, 44. And it is possibly the most difficult aspect of Christianity for us to accomplish. The Bible says this, Jesus speaking at the Mount, the Sermon of the Mount, he says, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. That's what you heard it said. That's what they said in the past. But I say to you, Jesus, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute. Paul in jail for two years, unable to speak. The people that cursed him, that wanted him dead, he raises their hand and prays over them, blessing. Where is Paul's heart? Because can we be real? How many of us could do that? How many of us, if we, in retrospect, think about it, when someone has done us dirty, done us wrong, how many have we condemned them straight to hell? How quickly have we done that? Paul had this in his heart. He knew this teaching from Jesus. And he knew that even in his suffering, the circumstances he was going through, God had ordained this moment for something positive. Something amazing was going to happen here. He couldn't understand it. And if you were in jail with Paul, I'm sure there were moments of doubts. He's like, okay, Lord, year one. It's been a year and a half now. What are you doing, Lord? When is this going to end? When is there an opportunity? And here it is now in year two. And look at the words that come out of Paul's mouth in verse 2. He says, King Agrippa, I am happy. Paul, you've been in jail 2 years. They've beaten you. You've been in chains. You're happy? That word happy means to be joyful, means to feel blessed and highly favored. Paul has been in jail for 2.5 years, and the first things that he said to the crowd, the accusers, I feel blessed to be here. Oh, I'm so happy to be in front of you. Thank you for this moment. Thank you for this opportunity. What is going on in Paul's mind? Now, some of you might think, you know, you're like, you know what? Paul's got a scam going. He's trying to suck them in, right? He's trying to get them soft and to make them feel good. And then, boom, he's going to come after them, right? He's going to want them to take off, you know, the chains, and they're going to feel comfortable. And then he's just going to attack them. That's how we would probably think, right? We think, man, he's trying to butter them up. He's trying to make his circumstances better. No, this is actually really how he feels. He feels blessed in this moment. And why does he feel blessed in this moment? Because he says this, you have heard my Jewish accusers. Now it's my turn to speak. He now has an opportunity before the highest ranking Roman and Jewish leaders to now speak the truth. He has a full form. Where he's held at, and I didn't bring a picture of it, in Caesarea, as King Herod's had a castle, basically, that sat on the Mediterranean. It must have been, I want to say, somewhere around 20 acres. But his palace, which overlooked the Mediterranean, is where they held court. And so imagine Paul here, imagine this room filled 4 times over. That's his audience. See, he has all the important people, the presidents, the kings, the mayors, the governors, all the social people, all the people who have value, all the people who have money have come. And this is why he's happy. He's pleased that God has given him this opportunity. I have to give you that foundation. There's our foundation. And maybe now you can walk in his footsteps. Maybe you've placed yourself right there. Because now what's going to occur truly is something that can't come from our own flesh. This has to be God in us moving. And so now courtroom is all set. And now Paul is going to respond to King Agrippa. It's verses 4 through 11. Acts 26, verse 4 through 11, I'll read through them. The Bible says this. These are Paul's words. My manner of life from my youth, which was spent from the beginning among my nation at Jerusalem, all the Jews know. They knew me from the first, if they were willing to testify, that according to the strictest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee. And now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made by God to our fathers. To this promise, our 12 tribes earnestly serving God night and day hope to attain. For this hope's sake, King Agrippa, I am accused by the Jews. Why should it be thought incredible by you that God raises the dead? Indeed, I myself thought I must do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth. This I also did in Jerusalem, and many of the saints I shut up in prison, having received authority from the chief priests. And when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them, and I punished them often in every synagogue and compelled them to blaspheme. And being exceedingly enraged against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities. Pause right there. Let me get your attention. If you're taking notes, point number two, the hopeful promise that supersedes accusations. The hopeful promise that supersedes accusations. Verses 4 and 5, Paul starts out sharing that since a tiny little toddler, since a very young age, I was a Jew. I lived out. I was trained up in the ways of Judaism. And not just in the ways of Judaism, but the formal ways of Judaism through schooling and temple and sitting under a rabbi teacher. And he kind of shoots a dig out there and he says, and maybe the Jews will testify this because they know. See, Paul throws that out there to say, listen, they know me. Everyone in here who's Jew knows my story. Now, whether they would testify it or they're going to lie, I don't know. But then in verse 6 and 7, he gives Agrippa the reason why he's been accused. The reason why for 2 years he was put in jail. He says this, he stands and judge in the hope of the promise made to Israel. This promise was expected by Israel day and night. They served God. Why was Paul in jail? For the promised hope. What was the promised hope of Israel? The anointed one, the Messiah, the one to come, the King of Israel. This is why Paul is in jail. And he shares this. This was the promised hope. Where's this promised hope come from? It comes from the very beginning, right after the fall of Adam and Eve. God makes the promise of the one to come, the anointed one, the Messiah. It's Genesis 3:15. Genesis 3:15. The Bible says, and I will put enmity between you and the woman. God is speaking to Satan. He says, I'm going to put a divide between you and the woman, Eve. And he says, and between your seed and her seed, he shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. This is the very first scripture that speaks of the Messiah, of the gospel. God promises that there will be one to come that will step right on Satan's head, will supersede Satan, will overcome death. This was the hope of Israel. There was one to come, an anointed one. Jacob, in his last words to his sons, Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, says this in Genesis 49:10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh comes, and to him shall be all the obedience of the people. Israel, Jacob, as he's dying to his sons, he says, be ready. There's an anointed one coming. There's a Messiah coming. And so Paul in this verse says, hey, King Agrippa, hey, Jews, we are all expecting the Messiah, the anointed one, to come. This is why I've been arrested. because I proclaim that Jesus is the anointed one. I have proclaimed that he is the Messiah, and these other Jews do not agree with me, yet all the proof is there. That's why I'm being arrested. This is what he lays out before King Agrippa. And then he throws this question, which is really a question. He wants King Agrippa to think about it. Now remember, King Agrippa, to be king of that area, being a Roman, he would have to know the people. You had a governor, and then you had a king over a certain land. And this is the way the Romans did their government. And so the king had to know who he was governing. So he knew the Jewish faith, at least understood what they believed in. He knew in their culture. He knew what festivals that they would have. He knew everything about them. He knew what they believed, and even some that didn't believe. Because remember, the Pharisees believed in God, and so did the Sadducees. But the Pharisees believed in resurrection. The Sadducees did not. So King Agrippa would know all this. And so in the midst of all this, look at the question that he throws out to the king. Why should it be incredible to you that God raises the dead? What is he throwing at King Agrippa? He's throwing this idea of resurrection. He's throwing this idea of, if I'm telling you that the reason I'm in jail is because I believe Jesus Christ is the Messiah, and we know the accounts of Jesus the Messiah, that he was killed on the cross, but yet in 3 days was resurrected. King, is that impossible for God? So he just throws that there. Now, what we also have to understand is the Romans had gods as well. But the Romans had multiple gods, and their gods were powerful. See, King Agrippa would understand this power of a god. And so that's why Paul just throws that seed right at his feet. And so he plants the seed. But now he's going to go deeper into who he used to be. In the book of Acts, there are 3 times that Paul gives his testimony. And every single time, this being the 3rd time and the final time, every time he gives his testimony, he goes a little deeper, a little bit more explicit about who he was and what God did. And so in verses 9, 10, and 11, he begins to explain to King Agrippa who he really was and how he viewed the Christians in Jesus Christ at one time. And he shares that his thoughts were contrary to Christ. Paul, when he was Saul before the conversion, believed that anything that came from Jesus, anything that came from Christianity, anything that came from the way, he had to do the opposite. There was no gray area. There was no saying, well, you know what? Jesus is kind of right about this. No. He was taught in his heart before Christ, anything that they said is no good. Doesn't matter if they said, love your neighbor, love God. He was taught to go opposite of that. And with that heart set, now you see his actions. Look what he says, that what he used to do to Christians. He says he used to shut them up. That word shut up means to imprison them. At any given moment, as long as he was given authority by the chief priest, he found a Christian, even just shopping, even just taking a walk, even going to the gym, even praying, he would arrest them. Is this a picture of any place in the world you can think of right now? If you go to China right now and you announce your faith in Jesus Christ, they take you in right away. You are imprisoned. Go to some of the places in the Middle East. They will imprison you immediately. North Korea, they will imprison you right away for your Christian faith. This is who Paul once was, by order and ordained. But not only did he imprison them, he put people to death. He murdered them. He doesn't say how, but he was even authorized to vote to have someone murdered. The first account of the first Christian martyr of Stephen, Paul was there as Saul. Though Paul didn't authorize it, he voted to have Stephen killed. But one of the worst things, and probably in my mind as I read 2 Corinthians, that he would do was he would compel Christians to denounce their faith. He would force them, under whatever circumstances, to renounce their faith, and then he would release them. Why is this worse than death? Well, Paul in 2 Corinthians has been praying to God. He's now saved and he's walking, but he says there's a thorn in his side. And he's asking God three times to remove it, this thorn. Theologians have said, well, you know, maybe it was his eyesight, because there's scripture that says it was his eyesight. But many believe that that thorn in Paul's side, that the thing that he had to live with, is that he forced Christians to denounce their faith. And he didn't know if they came back. In denouncing their faith, he had to live with this idea that there were people that he persecuted that maybe never came back to the faith, and he's not sure if they have salvation when they die. Many theologians says that was the thorn in Paul's side. But this is what Paul would do. Once again, have we not seen that in Egypt with the Coptic Christians? As ISIS took these 12 men, took them to the desert, and told them to denounce their faith in video. And we know the account, these 12 men refused. And with one swipe, they lost their heads and then were martyred. Understand, my brothers and sisters, this is not just history. This is going on now. We need to wake up. Church, we need to be awake to these things. We need to understand that this is not far from our borders. COVID showed us a sign of our government that is still reeling with the church. Canada, right across the border, has shown this clearly. Let us not think that this is far from us. But this is who Paul was. Then he shares why he was like this. He says he was exceedingly enraged. Now think about that word, enraged. If you picture the word enraged, you probably think of someone going absolutely crazy, right? Maybe you've seen it in movies. Maybe you've actually happened to you. What does exceedingly enraged must look like? What must have been his mindset, his heart set, that he was exceedingly enraged with the word Christian, with the word Jesus? This is why he could murder, he could blaspheme, he could do all these horrible things, because in his heart spewed nothing but anger and hatred over and over and over. I want us to think about this idea of anger, because as a church, we think, you know what, anger is not a part of who we are. But we would be fools to not to think that doesn't exist, because anger is part of who God is. Now, there's righteous anger, and we see that with Jesus in his act in Matthew 21:12, where he turned over the tables because they were selling goods and there were thieves in the temple. That was a righteous anger. But I want you to think about this as a Christian, that our anger now and how we react to it. Because the truth of the matter is that we are not far off from turning into a Paul under circumstances. What does the world teach us? Especially, I mean, if you like action movies, I remember in the past, you know, and they're always about retribution, right? Dirty Harry, right? You know, all the Stallone movies, right? We got it paid back. Where do you think that mentality comes from? Anger. Christians, that can come up because our lives are not perfect. We have people who will turn against us. And we need to understand this anger that Paul had. This was an anger that overwhelmed him. It was a venom. It was poison in his, so much so that he could take a life just like that. This was the Paul. But we have to picture that as well because, once again, transparency, as a kid, I had anger management problems. Major anger management problems. I used to have anger that they would call blackout stages. And if you never heard what blackout stage is, you're so enraged that all of a sudden you're doing something you don't even remember you did. And usually had to do with violence. What would happen to me, and if you remember, for those who remember playing the dozens, which is a kind of a game where you talk about people's family and, you know, and it gets funny and jokes. So, but I always had a rule that you can talk about everybody, but you couldn't talk about my mama. You could talk about my brother. And I give it back to you, but don't bring on my mama. Oh, no. She was sacred. And the kids in the neighborhood knew that. But the ones who still wanted to test me would say something about my mama. And I would fly into a rage. There was one time we were playing basketball. And I scored on this friend of mine, close friend. And he, I took him to the hole. Yeah, bro. I used to have skills back in my days. I could take you down. Back then. I don't know about now. Someone got his back. But he didn't like it. So I showboated. And from about 50 feet away, he said, "Your mama." And the next thing I remember, my PE coach and four of my friends are trying to pull me from killing him. I had my hands around his throat. Believe me, I understand that that anger sits in the depths of my soul. I'm not completely gone from that, but I need to have awareness of that. And as we understand Paul, and so I want us to look at that because the key to us dealing with anger as Christians, and why am I sharing this with you? Because persecution comes to Christians. And how we react to it is key. Because what have you seen from Paul? You haven't seen that anger come out. But we will be quick to do that. And so what we need to understand is Proverbs 15:18. When it comes to our anger, it says this: a hot-tempered person stirs up conflict, but one who is patient calms a quarrel. So the first thing as a Christian is what we have to understand is when we get that anger, when we get that person pushing our buttons, when we feel the government is treating us wrong, we need to take counsel, our own self-counsel of what we're feeling. Because if we don't grab hold of it, if we don't grab our thoughts and captivate them, this can escalate. But then the answer is once you captivate it, what do you do with it? Psalm 139, 23 and 24 says this: "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties. And see if there's anything wicked way in me. And watch this. And lead me to the way of everlasting." See, once you recognize the anger that's possibly built up in you, or any attribute that would go against God, once you recognize it, now it's time to take it to the Lord. Amen. Now it's time to place it before him and say, "Lord, you got to do something in my heart. Search me. I don't want to be this way." Paul never recognized this in his walk on his own. It wasn't until that fateful day onto the road to Damascus that Paul recognized who he was as a person. And so Paul has now shared his basically history as a Jew to King Agrippa. He's laid a foundation. He's even explained why he's accused. Now he's going to close out by sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ to him. It's Acts 26, verses 12 through 18. Acts 26, verses 12 through 18, the Bible says this. While thus occupied, as I journeyed to Damascus with authority and commission for the chief priests, at midday, O king, along the road, I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shining around me and those who journeyed with me. And when he had fallen to the ground, I heard a voice speaking to me and saying in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. So I said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom you're persecuting. But rise and stand to your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness both of things which you have seen and the things which I will yet reveal to you. I will deliver you from the Jewish people as well from the Gentiles to whom I send you, to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and the inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Pause right there. Point number three, and the last point, the hopeful promise that brings salvation. The hopeful promise that brings salvation. He's now got King Agrippa's and the entire court, he's got them captivated. He's laid it all out. And then now he's going to tell them of his conversion. He's going to give his testimony of how he came to know the truth of the Messiah. And he gives such great detail. Why is this important? If you've ever been in court, it's all about the details. If you're going to go before a judge to hear a claim or to hear your case or to hear your defense, you better have details. Paul is giving them details. King Agrippa is just sitting there. He says, listen, he gives them the road to Damascus. He now takes them there in Syria. And he tells them, I was ordered by the chief priest. Here's my command to go kill and round up Christians. And watch this. He says, midday. This is so that way the king would understand that when this light that shone from heaven, it wasn't the sun, because it's midday. And then he says, he's not the only one who saw it. He was not alone. Now he tells the king Agrippa, there was witnesses there. He's now laying out his case. And now he shares the actual meeting with Christ. And that Jesus calls out his name twice, Saul, Saul. When you hear that in Hebrew, and once again, King Agrippa would understand this because he knew the culture. When something was repeated twice, it was kind of that thing of, are you listening? You know, I remember as a kid, my mom calling me from inside the house, Edward Rivera, Edward Rivera. And she would call me Edward because I was doing something wrong. That was the only time she called me Edward. So don't call me Edward because I get flashbacks of things I did wrong. But she would call out my name twice. In this culture, when you got called out twice, it was to grab your attention. And he called him by his Jewish name, Saul. And he specifically asked a question that's rhetorical. Why are you persecuting me? Jesus does not say, why are you persecuting my people? Why are you persecuting the ones that I love? No, Jesus reveals that what Paul was doing, the killing and hurting and the suffering of the Christian, was personal to him. It was like you were doing it to me. He lays this out. And then Jesus tells him, isn't it hard to kick against the goads? Isn't that something that this, once again, is a cultural thing? Goads is basically a wood spike. And so this is how culturally this works. You had a horse or donkey or some type of cattle pulling a cart. Most donkeys and animals don't want to be pulling no cart. After a while, they get a little upset that they're pulling this thing. And so what do? They kick. That's what the goat is for. Because when they kick, they hit a spike. And they're like, ooh. And they continue to do what they're called to do. You see the analogy? God is telling Paul, Saul at this time, why are you kicking against the goat? Don't you feel that what you're doing is wrong? Don't you see that it's me you're going against? When are you going to stop doing this? All of a sudden, he asked this question, is it you, Lord? Yeah, it's me, Lord. And so now we see Paul sharing this moment. And then in the last verses, Paul is going to recite exactly Jesus' words to him. And I want you to understand this as we close. Because we're not, unfortunately, there's going to be a part two to this next week. We're not going to see what happens when Paul's done sharing. This is a cliffhanger. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to do it to you because Pastor told me to. He said, don't go past 18. You're going to mess me up. So I'm going to honor my pastor, so I won't go past 18. But look what Jesus tells Paul. He says, rise to your feet. Paul's blind. Paul was blinded. What this tells us is when Jesus calls, it doesn't matter if you can see or not, stand. You may not be able to see what Jesus is doing in your life, but stand and walk. Just listen to his voice. He'll carry you. So he tells him to stand and walk. Then he gives him a task and he says, I want you to be a minister. That word has been altered in our vocabulary. Minister means I want you to be a servant. I want you to be a slave to me. Then he says, I want you to be a witness. That witness is now I want you to be a mouthpiece for me. I want you to talk about me. I want the words that come off your lips to be about me and whoever I bring your way. This is what I've called you to do. You know, we have a saying right now in law enforcement, if you see something, say something, right? And that usually that came about from 9/11 because of terrorist acts. If you see something, say something. Where did they get that from? They got that from Jesus telling Paul, if you see something, say something. If I tell you to speak, you say it. And here is what will happen. He says, I'm going to deliver you. That deliverance may not necessarily mean personally, but that deliverance is eternal. And he says, from Jews and Gentiles, he's like, listen, there's going to be a point. They've got no say. You're going to be with me. But in the meantime, this is what I'm going to have you do. I'm going to have you open up eyes. Because there are a lot of blind people out there that don't know the truth of who the Messiah is. You're going to bring people in the dark to light. There are people living in darkness. And we're not talking about poverty. We're talking about eternal darkness, a spiritual darkness. And that you're going to share the truth of Jesus Christ with them, and that's going to bring them into the light. And what you're going to do for me is going to release people from the bonds of Satan into my hands. This is what I've called you to do. And why is this going to happen? Because once they accept me, I will forgive them, and I will give them their inheritance. That is the gospel. Jesus ends this conversation with Paul by saying how he looks at you and me who are believers. We're sanctified by faith in him. We are his children. And so Paul's conversation with the king ends. And unfortunately, so does his teaching. Pastor will conclude it. I'm going to ask the worship team to come on up. But we started with this idea of a hopeful promise. A hopeful promise. And this is what instilled and stirred up Paul. I showed you through the scripture what Paul's life was like for the past 2 years, who he faced, and yet before all his accusers, he raises his hand in blessing, shares the truth about who he used to be, the horrid person that he was, and then turns it around and shares what Jesus did for him. And he lays this at the Romans and the Jews alike as a seed to be planted and for hearts to be changed. That hope of that promise was fulfilled in part when Jesus came in on Palm Sunday on that donkey. See, the scriptures tell us prophetically that the Messiah, the anointed one, would come in on a donkey as the king. Paul knew this. This was what was in his heart. He understood that the promise was fulfilled. This is how much God loves me. That he would allow his son to come into a land. Yes, to start off with praise and glory, but to end initially in ugliness and in horror, but yet for Resurrection Sunday. And so Paul's heart was full of this hopeful promise. My brothers and sisters, do you live in that hopeful promise? Do you know the promises that he has offered? The promises that he's fulfilled already in your lives, and a promise that he still yet has for you. You see, if we don't have that in our hearts, we can easily turn from the ways of the Lord. We can easily be stumbled by a world out there that hates Christ, that wants nothing to do with him. But yet we are called to the Jews and the Gentiles as believers to love on them, to speak to them, to show compassion for them. If not for the hopeful promise in you and my heart, we can't do that. We will be a stumbling block. And that's not what the church is called to do. The example is Paul. 2 years in prison, falsely accused, and the very first thing that he does in front of his accusers is bless them. We have to search our hearts, and it is not easy. I'm not going to sit here and lie to you and tell you to love others is easy. It's not. It's not in our normal routine. It's not part of our normal heart set and mindset. It is only something that can come through a relationship with Jesus Christ, and not just a knowledge of Jesus Christ. I'm talking about an intimate relationship with him. One day you hear him speak. In the quiet still of the night, you can hear his voice. When you cry out to him, he speaks words of comfort. The most comforting thing that Jesus ever spoke to me in my years of walking with him, as I was seeking an answer for something irrelevant, he came to me and he said, "Eddie, I love you. You who are a sinner." I shake still to remember that moment. And this is who he is. And this is the hope that his love will carry us from day to day, from moment to moment. Once again, this walk's not going to be easy. Children, family, jobs, bosses, a world that hates our faith, it mounts up. But Jesus says, pick up your cross, follow me, for my yoke is light and my burdens is life. So tonight, once again, I said tonight, today, I just exhort you. I want to pray for you right now. As we celebrate Palm Sunday, you heard the gospel. You heard the gospel from Paul's own lips to non-believers. We know that it all starts and ends with Jesus Christ. In our faith in him, and then in our obedience. And I can't close without at least giving someone the opportunity, whether it's even here in the house or someone online who's listening. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you've never done what Paul says to do in Romans 10, to confess it with your lips that Jesus is Lord, if you've never done that, I'm going to open up the opportunity right now and ask anyone who wants to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, just raise your hand right where you're at, that you would this day decide to make it the day that you would forever follow him. So if there's anyone in the house that wants to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, just raise your hand. I just want to pray for you. If there's anyone online who's heard this message, write in the comments, "Lord, save me." And one of our amazing servants will reach out to you. And so the house is full of Christians. I just want to have you open up your hands, and I want to pray this over you. Father, your children come before you right now. And oh, what a powerful thing you did to the Apostle Paul in his most difficult circumstances. And Father, right now we are going through challenges. We are all facing challenges one way or another. And we need that hopeful promise to be stilled in our hearts, to captivate us. Not the anger, not the bitterness, not nothing that would separate from you, but your love right now. So Father, would you, by the power of the Holy Spirit right now, speak to your children, whoever it is right now that needs to hear this, that needs to feel your spirit right now, touch their hearts, to tell them, listen, my child, I love you, and I know you're going through challenges right now, but don't give up on me. Continue to walk in me. This too shall pass. This is for a season. But in that season, grow in me, trust in me, live in me. Know that I love you. Know that I walk before you. And so, Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters that they would receive that prayer right now, and that they would live in that prayer, that they would grow in that prayer. And as we continue to celebrate and commemorate Holy Week, that that would only strengthen us. And that would give us the boldness, the braveness to even reach out to those who are living in darkness, those closest to us, to say, I have an answer to your problem. And so go before them now, Lord, that they would be blessed by your touching their hearts, by you speaking to them right now, whatever it was that you spoke, and that they would walk in that forevermore. We thank you that you love us that much, Lord. We give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Why don't we stand? Let's worship the Lord.
Hosanna, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you for worshiping us with us today. There will be prayer counselors in the front, and you guys have a great week. See you on Good Friday, 6:30.